Hi, everyone. Let's talk about fluid mechanics. And usually we talk about a liquid, usually water, when we discuss fluid mechanics. But these same ideas also apply to gases, such as air. So here are some key concepts that come out of fluid mechanics, Chapter 5. So the first one is density. And that's defined to be the mass divided by the volume. It's a ratio. And density is a larger number with bigger masses, and density is a smaller number with bigger volume. So here we go. We got a brick and a sponge on the screen, and they roughly have about the same volume, but there's more matter or more mass in the brick, and we say it's more dense than the sponge. The sponge has all these air pockets, so there's not a lot of matter in the air pockets, just the mass due to the air, which is pretty small. Let's see what else. If you take a little chunk, break a piece of this brick off, and you rip a piece of the sponge off so they're about the same size, the density doesn't change, right? You just have a smaller amount of mass over a smaller volume, and the ratio is the same as if you take the whole brick, which is a lot more mass, divided by the whole volume, a lot more volume. It's a ratio, and it doesn't change with matter. Chemists like using density to identify materials because density is a property of a material. For example, gold is more dense than copper. And let's see, some plastics. There are some plastics that are more dense than other plastics. And so that's one way you can identify different types of plastics by their density. Here's some more examples about density. If we look at the Earth, the ground below us, the pressure, the weight, the crushing force of the material keeps squeezing stuff that's lower down within the Earth. And if you measure the density in grams per cubic centimeter, that's just another way of measuring volume. Take a cube, which measures 1 centimeter on each side, and that's a cubic centimeter. So measure, a cubic centimeter of the Earth near the top at the crust and weigh that little chunk of matter, and you get a ratio about 2.2 to 2.9. And as you go deeper in the Earth, the weight of the stuff above is crushing down on the weight below, and you're packing more and more matter into a smaller volume of space. So more mass, less volume, gives you a density that's larger. Until you get to the very bottom, or the center, that is, of the Earth, and things get pretty dense down there. Here's another example. This one's cool. We got a bolt down at the bottom, maybe made of iron. So lots of matter, heavy atoms of iron, all packed together in this bolt. We've got honey here, which is a nice, thick liquid, so a lot of material packed into a smaller volume. Corn syrup turns out to be less dense than honey. There might be some more gaps between the material, the molecules that make up corn syrup, than those that make up honey. Or the molecules themselves, the little objects, smallest chunks of corn syrup, they might be lighter. They're lighter than the molecules that make up honey. And so density is mass over volume. So there's two things that could be happening here that makes corn syrup less dense. It could have lighter or smaller amounts of matter, or those material could be stretched out more and occupy more volume. That would make the density less. And then what's kind of cool is that the less dense materials float on those that are lighter. You can use the same idea over here with the Earth. You could say that the material that makes up the inner core is more dense, it sinks, and the material that makes the outer core floats on the inner material, on the inner core. And this material floats on that, and this material floats on that. That all works the same way. Kind of hard to think about the Earth being liquid, though. So this is a nice, more vivid example. We got maple syrup being less dense than corn syrup, then milk, dish soap, and water. And then we have some vegetable oils and rubbing alcohol, lamp oil, and a ping pong ball filled with air. So that's the least dense of all. And then they added some food coloring or something, the alcohol. rubbing alcohol is clear. Lamp oil, well, maybe it's that color. Or maybe they add some coloring too. That's kind of cool. The dye, it's hard to see the little six-sided dye, you know, playing games. Let's see. Popcorn kernel, that's pretty dense. Sinks all the way down to here, to the maple syrup. But doesn't sink any much doesn't sink farther than that because honey and corn syrup are more dense than the popcorn kernel. And the bolt's the most dense of all. Greatest amount of mass divided by the least amount of volume. Okay, after density, which is mass divided by volume, let's talk a little bit about pressure, which is force divided by area. And here we got a couple beds of nails. This guy's lying across it. Doesn't look too uncomfortable. Bunch of nails here. More remarkably, we got a rubber balloon that's being squeezed between this block and this mini bed of nails. And obviously the balloon's not popping, and it is being pressurized here. It's being deformed by the weight of the block. So why isn't it popping? Well, you might argue some of the nails, or all the nails that is, they're probably not too sharp, but they're going to have some type of point to them. And that balloon's getting pretty squeezed down pretty hard. And what about this guy? I mean, ouch, this arm is exposed. Maybe the jeans are protecting him a bit. But that arm is all exposed. But you imagine probably the bulk of the weight, it's across his torso and not a lot of weight on the hand or arm. So the force, the weight force here, is probably not too great. But the main idea is there's a lot of area here. Sure, across one nail, the tip of the nails doesn't have much area, but there's lots and lots of nails. And all that area from the tip of the nails adds up. So you have a significant amount of area that spreads out that force. Now the real question is, how do you get on here? you know, you don't want to just stand on one foot and get on here, because then that applies a lot of pressure, a lot of force over a small area, just the bottom of your foot. And then that you might actually cut yourself. So you have to carefully lay across this, not applying too much force in any one area as you spread your body out. Next, we have the buoyant force. The buoyant force, well, it sounds like a buoy, something floating on the water. The buoyant force is the net upward force that a liquid exerts on an immersed object. And it turns out Archimedes had this principle that this buoyant force, the upward force exerted by the liquid, you can calculate it. The buoyant force is equal to the weight of the displaced fluid. Okay, this is how it works. Let's imagine this ball is made of wood. And wood has weight. And so the weight force, gravity here, is pushing down on the wood and ball here. And it's going to push aside some liquid, if this is water. And so kind of imagine this little notched section of the water being taken out, and imagine how much water is there, and go weigh that. Well, the weight of the water that's been displaced out of the way, that's your buoyant force. So what we need to do is figure out the volume of the object that's into the liquid, and that amount of volume is used to calculate the buoyancy force, how much weight in that given volume of liquid. What's the weight force of that liquid? That is equal to the buoyant force. How much force is pushing upward on this object? Okay, over here we got a glass of water, chunk of wood floating in here, and before we put in the block of wood, the water level is right here, and afterwards the water level moved up because the block of wood takes up volume, kind of pushed the water aside. And you can measure this volume and then measure the amount of volume, or actually pour this amount of volume out and just weigh it. And that'll tell you how much the buoyant force is pushing up on this block of wood, keeping it from sinking. It's in equilibrium with the weight force. Okay. Boats, how come they float? Well, you might argue because they're made of wood. That's why wood is less dense than water, so it floats. But here's like, let's say this is a metal boat here, metal hull. And if you take all the metal of the hull and pack it together into a nice dense, dense in the amount of mass in a small volume, it'll sink. But if you take this same amount of metal, same mass, and you spread it out over a larger volume, make it less dense, fill up the inside with air, you know, flatten out the metal, spread it around, and that way the weight of this metal hull pushes down on the water and displaces a large volume of water, and then you weigh all that water that's been pushed aside, and that generates a significant buoyant force. Enough, in this case, to balance the weight force. Keeps the ship upright. If you pack it all together, then just measure the size of this cube, and that's your volume of the water displaced, and that's not a lot of water. And so the weight force, I'm sorry, not the weight force, the buoyant force is equal to the amount of water, the weight of the water displaced. So that's a small force. And now the weight of this big block of metal, it's much greater than the buoyant force, and it sinks. Same principle applies to people trying to float. Overall, you measure the weight of the person. That's the weight force making him sink. He or she. His lungs are inflated with air, so his chest cavity here doesn't have a lot of mass, right? A lot of that is air inside the lungs. And so the mass divided by the volume is not very great. It's low density, and yet the body's displacing quite a bit of water. So as the water displaces, weigh all that water, that gives you some buoyant force. And it turns out, if it takes a good breath of air, displaces more water displaces, increases the buoyant force, and lifts him up, so he floats. If he exhales all that air, he increases the density of his body. Not a lot of air in the legs. And so this tissue, the muscle, and the bone, and the blood, that's all more dense than water. And so that's a lot of weight force, and the amount of water displaced by the legs, measure that amount of water, and that gives you a buoyant force, which unfortunately doesn't equal the weight force. And so his legs are sinking. And the same thing will happen to his whole body if he exhales deeply and increases the density of his chest. You know, shrinks it by pushing out the air, compacting his chest, ejecting that air, so it's mainly just bone tissue, blood, much more dense material, and then he'll sink. Now, we did all our examples with buoyant force with water, but you don't have to. Here's mercury, a very dense liquid, and we got a coin floating on that. So two metals. A solid metal and a liquid metal. It turns out this metal, I don't know, is that silver? 2004? Probably not silver. It's probably copper with nickel across the top or something. Anyways, copper, nickel, even silver are much less dense than mercury. So measure the volume displaced by the coin and weigh that amount of mercury, and that's your buoyant force. And then take the weight of the coin, that's your weight force, and it turns out the mercury exerts a greater, well, not greater, equal. It's an equal force to the weight force and keeps it from sinking. Switch to a different fluid. Turn to a gas, which is air. And if this is a hot air balloon, well, it turns out that hot air expands, so the same amount of matter can occupy a larger volume of space. So the density is, you know, air doesn't weigh a whole lot, low amount of mass. And cold air has a lot of density. But if you take that same amount of air and spread over a bigger volume, that's hot air. And now this ratio, a small number divided by a big number, you know, like 1 divided by 1,000, that's a pretty small number, 1/1,000. If you take 1 divided by 100, smaller volume, then that's a not as, you know, that's actually a larger fraction compared to 1,000. It's more dense. Cold air is more dense, goes down. Hot air rises, it floats. Hot air floats on cold air. You fill this with helium, same idea. Helium is much less dense than regular air, and that's because the molecules that make up helium much lighter than the molecules make up air. Okay, finally, last topic for Chapter 5, Bernoulli's Principle. This states that the pressure in a liquid decreases. The pressure decreases as the velocity of the fluid increases. So they're opposites. So consider a pipe, got a whole bunch of, let's just make it water, flowing in the one end of the pipe. And it's exerting a pressure on the pipe, especially as it makes this turn here. And as it narrows down, the fluid has to speed up. It's being forced through the small section, and then it expands over here, and it slows down. Well, it turns out that if you measure the pressure, you get a little pressure gauge in here, measure the pressure, and you measure the pressure over here, the liquid at slow speed is actually exerting a higher pressure on the walls of the tube. The liquid that's moving very fast, very rapidly, doesn't have a chance to exert a lot of pressure. I like to think of it as a little, the little things, little molecules that we'll discover later on. The molecules that make up water or whatever fluid it is, if they're moving slowly, they're colliding quite a bit with the side of the wall. And so it has a chance to exert a lot of pressure. But if they're, moving quickly, they don't have a chance to collide with the wall and not much opportunity to push on the walls and create pressure. Bernoulli's principle gives us a way to understand how airplanes fly. So here's the side view of an airplane wing. And these little contour lines here are trying to explain how the air gets pressed together, kind of like pressed together in this smaller region, and the air flows more quickly across the top of the wing than it does below. If the air flowing underneath is at higher pressure, while it's moving slower, it can push quite a bit on the bottom of the wing, and the air that's flowing much faster doesn't have a chance to push on the top of the wing. And so the forces pushing down and pushing up are not the same. Underneath the wing, it's pushing harder. And then it causes lift. That's what's down here in this other diagram here. I like these little arrows. So the faster moving air doesn't have a chance to push down on the top as much, with as much force, as the slower moving air can push up and generates lift. There we go. Just some more diagrams here. Explain the same thing. Okay, thanks for watching.